BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
NAP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art issues with three guests and the host, James Carroll. Home viewers are invited to call and offer comments or questions during the live telecast. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit art service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Well, good afternoon. Hi, and welcome again to another edition of NAP Connections. I'm your host tonight. I'm Ron Schira, and I would like to introduce to you tonight a very special guest, an artist, the mixed media painter. This is Mike Hale. And Mike is a local guy. About where are you from? What area?
Gilbertsville,
right?
Actually, from Gilbertsville. Yeah. Right now, currently, yes.
Currently,
yes.
Well, who knows what will happen?
No, I don't think I'm. I love it there.
You're going to stay there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
If that's like me, I'm done.
Yeah, I'm done. I'm well, rooted. I got too much artwork. I'm pushing max intensity. I don't want to think about moving it.
No, that's a horror story. You know, I even think about that, it gives me the willies. Well, anyway, Mike, tell us about yourself. How, you know...
I'm originally from Western Pennsylvania, a place called Murraysville, Pennsylvania, which is actually about 40 miles to 50 miles from Pittsburgh, kind of like how we are from Philly.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up there, had a great childhood, grew up in a small little school with a lot of talented kids that were very talented, and I'm sure half of us would probably have been Medicaid by now, but most of them turned out pretty well, and I was one of them.
Most of us are still medicated.
I'm serious.
Yeah.
And we went there to high school, and then high school, I was doing art all the time. And actually, I got by, I used to make great Valentine boxes, and I did art all the time as a kid. And I wasn't very good in school, so I did a whole lot of extra credit. You know, and I was drawing pictures for extra credit, and I tell you, that was... Really, a lot of that got me through school.
That's nice, though.
Yes.
I remember being the artist in the class and them saying, well, we have a dance coming up. Ron, can you do posters?
Oh, yeah.
Can you paint on the windows?
I painted gymnasium floor, you know. It was like that. I love school, but my attention span wasn't all that great. So I used to, my notes look like artwork and that kind of thing, you know. I did a lot of that, and then in high school, I excelled at being an athlete. But also, I did a lot of illustration work and a lot of painting, and I had a lot of art classes in high school. And also, I was fortunate enough to my relatives put me through Saturday classes on Saturdays on the weekends on campus at Carnegie Mellon.
Mm-hmm.
And I would take a bus from the suburbs to Carnegie Mellon, and that was, I'm a people person, and not so much the educational part, but for me, the surroundings. I mean, to take a transit bus to Pittsburgh, it took an hour or so, you know, I'm dodging Hare Krishnas and that kind of stuff, and get off on the campus and go to the campus and have art courses. That was just amazing. You'd walk into these great big stone buildings with the marble floors, and you could hear people, you know, doing their scales on piano, and it would echo. And then there was a little gallery there. I remember going by the little gallery, and it had Pearlstein artwork in there, you know, with the artwork, with the big hands and big feet.
Right, Philip Pearlstein.
And the classes, you'd go into the rooms, and in the hallway would have been what the students did all week, and very inspiring. I mean, here I was, it's like 1978, and I was already doing figurative drawing of nudes and things. Yeah, it was amazing. And, And we had fundamentals art there and that kind of thing. So I did that for a couple summers and, you know, a couple years. And then, it's funny though, I never remember bringing any artwork back. I think by the time I would get off the transit bus, it either got destroyed or...
Or lost or stolen.
Or stolen.
Yeah.
I never knew what happened to it. And then I was very fortunate. Pennsylvania, somewhere in 78, 79, did a program. It was called Summer Happening. And the schools, it wasn't the schools, it was a state, would select certain students from different schools that were talented. So you'd submit your resume or was recommended, and they would jury it. Mm-hmm. And then I had a chance to spend a long period of time at Indiana University on campus with a whole bunch of other students from all around the state. Indiana was one of the schools, and another one, I can't remember, but you lived like a college student. So we would, you know, here we are, high school kids. You had, there were girls, guys, you stayed in the dormitory, you had painting, you had photography, you would go visit artist studios, you would go to recitals.
So it's kind of like the mentoring.
It was excellent.
Yeah.
I mean, for a high school kid. So I was fortunate to have that also. Did that. Had some great classes, and then eventually I had great art teachers. I had a great art teacher that really influenced me to pursue college. At that time, you know how it is. I looked at colleges, but we didn't have a whole lot of money, you know, and, so state school was a way to go, and IUP is where I ended up. Awesome school, awesome.
So IUP is Indiana.
Indiana University of Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
Great teachers there. I had lots of painting, and I drew. I did lots of paintings and drawings. That was really my main focus.
So you studied academic artwork at the time. So you went through all the anatomy perspective, negative space.
I had figure anatomy drawing almost every semester.
Yeah,
and I had painting and concentrated a lot on painting and had shows and I. College was awesome. I didn't really like the first 2 years, and I was there early. I was there in 1978, and I graduated in 85. The reason was that I was in sports.
Right.
I'm a very good runner, and I went there early for cross country and stuff. But at the same time, I was there, I really started to like it, and it was so cool. I mean, you know, it was like, wow, you know, you got girls, you got three hots and a cot, and you know, and you go all these different events, and you know, films of the 50s and 60s, and really, it was awesome, awesome. And then I finally I graduated in 1985 with a BFA, and then I had a job opportunity out here, and then I moved out here. So instead of go west, young man, I went this way.
You went east, So, well, welcome to the eastern side of the same state.
Yes.
You know, but it's a big state.
The whole time, I mean, I got out of college, you know, college at the time I was there, it was mostly, you were an artist. You did art. You come out and you had this idea that you were going to be bohemian and you were going to be in your studio, you know, with a little hat on, drinking and just having a good time. But it changes in reality when you got out.
Well, when it actually becomes a job.
Yes, it does. Yeah. And we didn't have marketing or anything like that at school either. You know, they really, they probably do now, but you really have to, you know, well, that's marketing.
That's the thing about the myth of being an artist.
Oh,
See, because you when you are young and all you're doing is just having fun, you love to paint, you love to draw, you love to do this sort of stuff. But how do you make a job out of it?
Well,
how do
you
make
money, you know, out of it? I was selling art even when I was a little kid. I'd sell art at little fairs and things. And it was a lot easier to impress people. And that was the fuel for the fire, was impressing people, And the more you impressed them, it might be even a bunny rabbit or something, or somebody's whatever, but it was still fuel for the fire. It's tough now. There's just too many things going on now to impress people so much. So you really have to work hard now.
You really have to work hard. You really have to, like they say, find a niche, dig yourself in, and stay there.
That's right.
You know, be like a trapdoor spider. Only come out when you see your prey. What we could do is, we have a lot of images.
Yes.
Of your work. So what we could do is, like, scroll through them,
Okay.
And, you know, you could talk about each one of the works individually. And, you know, we'll give some people insight into what you do. Now, but we need to say first that you switched from academic art to intellectual abstraction.
No, I always did. No, I seriously did abstraction even through college and all that, too.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
All right. So then sometime early, you decided that the non-image, you know, the non-representational was more important.
Actually, I do both.
You do both?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm also an illustrator, a cartoonist, and a carpenter, a builder, and a sculptor. So I have the luxury of doing all those different things.
Is that you or me?
Okay. It's not
me. We need to turn it off.
Well,
I need to turn it off.
Which plays a very important role with staying in the business.
Yeah.
Because you really have to be versatile if you really want to do. It all depends on who you know and what you know.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, I'm very versatile. If somebody wants something illustrated, I'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
Because I would rather do an illustration of a cat or a dog rather than go have to work somewhere and, you know,
mm-hmm.
it pays. But,
yeah.
You know, I'm very good at it. And the abstraction, it's a hard sell, especially when you paint paintings that are 8 feet by 7 feet,
mm-hmm.
unless you get corporate. And, well, that's a whole other discussion. We'll talk about that.
That's an whole
other
thing.
You get my point.
Okay. Well, I wanted to clarify that before we actually started showing the images, because I think people would be confused.
Sure.
We were talking about figures and stuff. Okay. Can we show the first image here, please? So, okay. So this is a work on paper, right?
That's correct.
So can you tell us about this?
This piece is titled Edge. It's basic dimensions is probably 40 inch by 39 inch. It was a piece I did for the, I had a show at the Ursinus College in Pennsylvania that would be filled mm-hmm. the mural Berman Museum of Art.
Uh-huh.
And it's actually acrylics, and it's also a gold leaf gild, which you see the shape, the sharp corner shape there, that's gold leaf.
Up here?
No, this large form over here.
This one?
Yeah, that's gold leaf.
Oh, that's all gold. Okay, so this area in here is all is all reflective.
Now, it's a heavy Archer's paper. My process is to apply an underpainting, and my underpaintings usually consist of a current, a flow through the painting, and if you look mm-hmm. at these paintings deep enough, you'll see sort of a rhythmic pattern that rolls through it. Then I actually paint layers and layers on top of the paper, and then it's wet sanded. And I'll wet sand it until I get back down to the certain heavier layers of paint that are exposed. So it's just glazes and glazes, and then the wet sanding removes the glazes and exposes this amazing artwork underneath, and
mm-hmm.
you rinse it off, and it's just these amazing different
so it's almost
designs
like
come out. You have no idea what it's going to look like.
But it's like chemistry, like you're putting all this stuff together, and what's going to and it kind of like forms under its own.
Yeah, you almost have to be able to visually think of what's underneath it because you bury it. It's hard to explain, but in your mind, you sort of have a mental picture. I call it flashback, too. When I retrieve something from the background, I call it flashback.
Mm-hmm.
And the upper layers are removed, but some of it remains. But what I'm bringing back is the underpainting by wet sanding it.
Right, but there's a trace of the overpainting on it,
yes.
which gives it kind of like a glazed appearance.
Yeah, it takes a little skill because mm-hmm. I tell you, with paper, you can't get too brutal with it because if you're sanding on it, you bring the tooth up real quick.
Right.
So you have to protect yourself.
Now, wet sand, when you say wet sand, you're talking about
automotive sandpaper, very fine grade, like what you use, like they use on cars.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You apply water on there and you sand it.
And you sand it
and
wet.
And you sand it.
Yeah.
And then, you know, your water gets, it gets all muddy.
Right.
But when you hose it off, it's like digging up gems or something. It's just
it's
beautiful colors come out in these, mm-hmm. you know, these.
It's like panning for gold.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah.
It really is. I'll discuss about the repeated patterns through these things.
Mm-hmm,
That's
mm-hmm.
another thing. It's rhythmic I love sound, I love the resonating sound, and that's another aspect that I put into these paintings that go from painting to painting to painting. I sort of identify with Mike Hale, I think.
That's one of your
It's a tempo, yeah. A pulse.
Mm-hmm. And also a trademark.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's something that you do that nobody does. Well, you also use other tools with it too, like stencils. You brought one along, right?
Yeah. This is called a ink brayer.
Can we come over to this and show this?
This is an ink brayer.
Okay. Hold on. There we go. Now we're
okay.
Now can you zoom in on this?
See this roller. Now, I use these also. You put a blob of paint down, you roll over, and it picks it up, and it repeats it.
Right. Well, let me hold it up.
Okay.
They're not seeing it. Can you come in on this? Who's got the camera? Can you come in on this?
Okay.
Okay, I guess not. So, you got it? All right.
It's probably close enough.
Well, I mean, it's a print roller.
Yeah, it's a print roller.
And you can use this for flattening down the images.
Well, also for picking up paint and repeating it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I build these in different sizes. Mm-hmm. I have one that's this long, this big around. I have another one that's this round, that's the barrel part of it.
Right.
And that space, that does a different spacing, a different tempo with each roll. So each roll, the paint is picked up and spaced differently.
Right.
So when you get to the larger pieces, there's different tempos, a shorter tempo and, well, that's and like, a longer tempo.
Well, that's like printer's ink.
Exactly.
That you would roll over a monoprint, like for type and stuff, and
exactly.
then that's like the old-fashioned pressed.
Yep.
You know, instead of taking everything photographic, digitalized.
Yeah. Word of advice: you have to have a smooth surface, though.
Yeah. Yeah.
It will break up, but the smoother the surface, the more likely it's going to hold its shape.
And that's why you sand.
Yeah. Well, that's new. I usually put that down as a base, and then I varnish over it, so that way when I do sand it, it won't come off. See, that's a sort of a protection from the sand.
So this is a process.
A process.
Yeah.
Yes. I have many processes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's a lot of really what defines today's art. A lot of today's art is processed.
Yeah.
Is process art. I mean, it involves a certain series of activities that conjoin in order to make the artwork. It's it's a combination, a cooperative between materials.
Okay, yeah, you can move on and see what you got
right.
there.
Well,
now that's a recent piece.
This is a recent piece.
Right.
Okay.
Now, I can't. I don't remember the name, Buck. You remember the name of that? Transition? That's not transition. But that's actually taped, and then a lot of taping. It also has the repeated pattern through, and that piece is actually 5 feet by 4 feet. There's also, in the winter, I usually get tighter. In the summer, I get looser. It's because I do a lot of things with a lot more paint, a lot more action painting in the summer, because I can take it outside and it dries.
Right.
In a winter, I do more of the taping and more of the line work and more of this geometric shapes in the winter. And this piece was probably done in the winter. And it's an amazing piece. I mean, you can get lost in that.
Well, in a size, too. What is it? It's like, what is it, 7 by 5 feet?
No, it's 5 feet by 4, maybe 4.5 feet.
5 by 4.5?
Yeah.
Now, these things also are pretty weighty, too.
No, that's on canvas.
On canvas.
That's not too bad. No.
Okay.
And it's also these pieces too. A lot of them I have them floated from the wall, so they have a 5-inch backer on it. So the canvas itself is floated from the wall and give you this other sense of dimension.
Right, floating images.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's cool. Let's go to the next one.
Okay, that piece is actually called Genesis. Can you flip it? the other way.
Can I flip it?
Yeah.
I can't do it right now.
Okay. That's actually called Genesis. I did that piece also for a show that I had at the Berman Mural Museum. And that piece is actually 7 by 8 feet.
That's 7 by 8 feet.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Well, then that's... Folks, just turn it 1/4 flip to your right on in your vision. This happens.
Do you see the line work? It's in there that looks amoebic. There are sort of these lines floating around there with the halos around it.
Right, this here?
That's actually poured paint. And in the summer, when I pour the paint, it will dry and it will stay elevated a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And then if I put a glaze over it, and then let it dry and remove the glaze from those lines. Since the paint is thicker than a glaze, it will leave a halo effect around those. And that's another really interesting thing to do, too. And it just really ties everything together and it gives it a little more movement.
But it's kind of like an imposed accident.
There's a lot of accidents I put in there. It's just graphically I put accidents. It may be an area that needs something, and I might even go with a pencil and scribble something just to give it a little more dimension and excitement.
Mm-hmm.
But I really like that piece. I tell you, it just goes from the light down to the dark and the deep.
Well, I'm imagining it myself. It looks like it could work no matter how you do it.
Well, that's a secret of mine. These aren't premeditated. I don't do sketches for these. Everything is started out with just throwing the paint and doing the roller thing, and then I build upon it. Mm-hmm. And one of my secrets is that I paint flat. I have a big wall, and I take my raw canvas, staple it down on an 8x8 foot wall, staple it down, dump maybe a half a gallon of gesso. I have a squeegee that's about this big. Squeegee it out. So it's action painting from the get-go. Squeegee it out.
Mm-hmm.
I let that dry. Throw paint, roll paint. That's my base. That's my undercurrent. And then I build upon that. It's a hard surface, so I'm able to get a little physical with it rather than just canvas flopping around. And then at some point, I can put the wall against... lift that flat surface up, which is a big panel with the canvas and the artwork to it, against the wall, and then use it as an easel. But I flip the artwork as I work on it. Flip it and flip it and flip it and flip it. So I'm watching all the time the design, the composition. So I'm flipping it and flipping it and doing art and flipping it and doing art and then flipping it and doing art. But the irony is, it always seems to come back to almost where I started it.
Mm-hmm. It seems like the best way is always the first way.
Yeah.
So when your original vision, when you work on that, I do the same thing. It's like you constantly turn turn the artwork. Well, for one, sometimes you just can't reach it.
Yeah.
But you're tall. You can do that. I'm short and squat, and I need stools, ladders, that sort of thing.
But it just ties everything together.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you get in a bad spot, and a lot of times you do, there might be a spot you favor, and you'll work around that spot, and you'll work around that spot, and you'll work around that spot, and you know what? Just get rid of that spot.
Yeah.
Get rid of it. Just get rid of it, and then. Well, you know what? Wow, that's great.
It frees you up, right?
Why was I stuck on that spot all that time?
Yeah, why was I even putting that there? Why was I even thinking this?
Yeah.
That's kind
of... Oh, yeah. I've had a lot of artwork like that. I like something, I work around that thing, get rid of it.
Yeah, don't try to fix it. Mm. Yeah. So go to the next one.
Oh, that's a more of a painterly piece. It's called New Day.
Uh-huh.
And that's actually just on canvas. And I like to, that you can actually see on that canvas how I rotate it, because you can see the runs on it. The runs are actually going horizontal.
Right.
There's pencil in there, that's acrylics.
Mm-hmm.
Very painterly, I like the painterly look of it, I like the colors of it.
Mm-hmm.
And also with these pieces too, these pieces have a painted edge, which is nice.
Mm-hmm.
I've done a lot of corporate work and residential work, and it's nice when it's installed. You can walk down a stairway, or you see your artwork the whole way around. So it's nice. It's really nice.
Yeah. So, do you find yourself attracted to any particular art form? You like abstract expressionism? Is there any artists that that you have found influential?
Yeah, all of them. But, you know, there's mm-hmm. one artist I did, like Egon Schiele, I guess. Egon mm-hmm, Schiele. Mm-hmm. When I had all my figurative drawings through school, I used to like sketching with a big pen, mm-hmm. you know, and I know he's kind of dark and sexual, but when you look at his line work and his drawings and stuff, it's this sort of overlapping of the lines and his translucency of it. And I tell you, as an abstract painter, that was the best thing I ever did, was having figurative drawing. Mm-hmm. You know, it sort of loosens you up and you learn something from that.
I think you learn to look.
Yes.
Because when you're drawing a figure, you have to make all kinds of decisions.
Yeah.
You know, or portrait. I painted portraits for a while. Okay, is his forehead actually shaped like this, or is it more straight? What's the angle of the curve?
You have to be very observant.
Yeah. So all of that kind of stuff matters. You know exactly where is the shadow lay underneath his nostril. You know.
But my sketchbooks, we'd like the gestural part, you know, they'd mm-hmm. be literally figures lined up, just done. And when you look at it, it's very abstract, these mm-hmm. lines going all over the place, and it's fluid, you know.
So you tend to draw first, or you just start, just paint?
I'm just saying that that's good experience if you can get it. If you can get it. You know, the figurative is really important.
Well, I think that most students, art students, always have figure drawing, and it's you know, people's attitudes are so.
Well, I had live nudes most of the time.
Yeah,
In 78 when I went, it was live nudes, and that's mm-hmm. totally different.
Oh yeah, it's a different thing.
Totally
now.
Different. Change, please.
Yeah,
that thing.
So okay, we'll go to the next one.
All right, this is a new piece. I had this done in. A recent show, maybe about a year or two ago, down in Old City, LG Trip Gallery. Mm-hmm. And these pieces are 8 feet, maybe 2-3 feet wide. And that's done with the roller technique.
Mm-hmm.
And they're really amazing. You look at them, it's just things speeding by. And also in these pieces, there's little flecks of color that you don't really see in this, but and they're also on wood panels.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it reminds me of that.
So I did a whole show with these different pieces like that.
Really? Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. That was in the Trip Gallery.
Yes.
Philadelphia.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, beautiful space. It was right across from the Arden. Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Really nice.
It reminds me of the photography by Edgerton, and you know, because you know that all that thing, like the people walking, and it's like it's like multiple exposures of. Kind of reminds me of that, only in.
But you can see that when you roll across, it starts fading off and becomes almost like a shadow.
Right.
As the and then when you go back over that again, and you get these really nice overlays, it mm-hmm. almost looks like shadows.
Like echoes.
Yes, yeah. Echoes.
This piece.
Yeah, that's titled In Your Long Arms. And you can also see the undercurrents there with the repeated patterns underneath mm-hmm, there. Mm-hmm. You can almost see in the top corner where the glaze, you know, the glaze is just a thin layer of paint that's painted over top, and that's easily removed. And you can see how the corners and around the edges, it's been removed slightly. Mm-hmm. This is actually a large piece too. You've probably seen this. It's around 5 feet by mm-hmm, 4 feet.
Well, you had this down in Boyertown, right? Is this the one?
I think this was down in Boyertown.
Uh-huh.
A lot of my drawings sort of revolve from like a conductor stroke, this sort of up and down and up and down, this composition thing. Mm-hmm. And you'll see these walls coming out at you that sort of envelop you. Mm-hmm. And that's why I call it In Your Long Arms.
Very nice, really. These are very physical pieces too.
Yes.
So when you get in front of one of these, it's like they actually authorize the space. It's like when they get there, it's like you know that this is a painting. It's got weight and radiance. It actually has a presence. It's a lot stronger than.
And there's flat areas and there's depth. And
yeah.
There's richness and color and you just go in and in and in and little accents and textures.
Right. Well, it's all part of that process. And right. One of the things that makes your stuff interesting is that when you do get in front of it,
right,
you tend to turn into a detective in a way, and you start to think like, well, how did he do that, and how did this happen?
In my mind, I'm thinking about the viewer, too, and I'm thinking about what kind of journey they can take in this piece. Where are they going to go? What kind of where are they traveling mm-hmm. in this piece? Mm-hmm. I know less is more, but I also like to have something very exciting for the customer or the viewer to look at.
Well, it's different ways of looking, different ways of experiencing. I mean, you can get in front of a Mark Rothko and appreciate its size and its text and its texture.
That's part of the look, the
right.
size. You know,
yeah, it's part of it because it just it's overwhelming.
Yeah,
but the work like this. It's much more complex, so that when you get in front of it, you have to figure it out, you know. Mm-hmm. And it applies to a whole bunch of different thinking processes too.
Right. You know, I've had critics have written up about my artwork in Philly and stuff like that, and you know, they're always like, oh, he's too involved in the process. Oh, he's too. You know what? I don't care. I have the time to do it. I have the time. This is what I do. It's my life. I've been doing this forever, and as much as I process I want to do, I have it, I mm-hmm. can do it. I don't care what anybody thinks.
That's right. Well, it's what you like. You're the artist. I mean, if you try to please everybody, they'll be like being pulled apart by horses, you know?
It's you're same, right. Yeah. I've developed these processes, and I'm sticking with them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and I love it. And I tell you, there are a lot of pieces that I love so much, I'll live with them, you know? That's how much I like them.
Yeah, you don't want to get rid of them.
No.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. I'll keep it. And this is probably one of them, actually. This is a really nice piece.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that is. You can really see it. Yeah, I mean, that whole upper right corner is really masterful. Like the way that
it rolls down over.
Yeah, and the way it folds up and it comes down again.
Also there's these painterly areas, just brush strokes. That's so you have this hard sort of forms undulating and shifting and moving, but then you have these brush strokes runs
mm-hmm.
that almost make it human. It gives it a human quality to it rather than this machine sort of changing.
Well, that's exactly what Willem de Kooning said, to keep it on a human scale.
Yeah.
I mean, if it's, you know, if it's on a personal human scale, that means you can reach every corner of the painting with your own body. But, I mean, some of these things, you walk in front of some of those recent Frank Stellas, I mean, it's crazy. It's 20 feet tall by, you know.
Yeah. I think a little bit of my work has a little bit of the accidental human quality to it, rather than looking so precise and so, you know, there's got to be some accidentals in it. And the runs and things like that are the things that I put in there, the pencil marks I put in there to give a little more human quality to it rather than mass produced.
You're allowing an imperfection.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's another piece in there I have a story about, dealt with the pencils, but no, I did a lot of pop art.
Okay, like that's a detail of this one,
right? I did these almost flashcards,
mm-hmm.
and I did simple items, but they're same thing. You know, mm-hmm. the artwork sanded down. I went through, these were series. I did, in my earlier works, I also did a lot of conceptual work. So this was rolling off the conceptual work through the 80s, mm-hmm. early 80s and 90s. It's a hard sell, conceptual mm-hmm. art.
So this one here, that's actually a top.
A top. Yes, okay. That's very large too. Yeah. I did like balls and tops and things, ordinary things, and did flashcards
mm-hmm.
of them. Mm-hmm. Back in the early days, back in college, I did flashcards like this, and I would take like mathematical equations, you know, like 2 minus 2, and then I would have like on the side, like big flashcard to be an illustration of 2 minus 2, like 2 minus 2, and then how much, you know, 2 underneath, and then I'd have soldiers, like 2 soldiers laying down, 2 soldiers standing up, and they're going to be 2 at the bottom, you know, something sort of like flashcards.
Like a, yeah, and almost like a political statement.
Yeah, it was funny because I did those way back like that with tanks and things like that, and here I see ISIS is using them as pamphlets, like using the same sort of thing for training things for kids. The same type of flashcard idea. Mm-hmm. Really strange. That's a piece that I had. It's actually a larger piece. That's a detail of King. Mm-hmm. That piece is actually, the full size of it was 5 feet. And that's a long story with this one. I had a show in Old City called The Elvis Years, and it was back early 90s, I guess, 93, 92. And it was all Elvis icons. And this was during the conceptual period. Mm-hmm. So I had all these icons. And I made it, the reason was because this mystique about Elvis, you know, he's a music messiah, and then, you know, he dies, and then people are seeing him, and you know, all this stuff. So I was making these icons, you know, like the type that you open up, the gold gilded with the big ones that light up, and I had these great big iconic photos. I, by chance, during the show, a woman came in from the collections of the Philadelphia Art Museum, and she said, you know, I love your work, and I know of this exhibition that's going to be traveling in the United States, and, you know, they might like this work because it's about Elvis. And
right.
I didn't realize it was about Elvis in Maryland. But I said, oh, okay, cool. And then she sent me the information, and I read it, and I sent my slides. You know, remember, we had everything in slides, and that was... So I sent it, and lo and behold, like a month later or two, I get a letter from Graceland. So I get this gold gilded letter from Graceland, and they want this piece. And so this piece eventually got into this Elvis Plus Maryland show.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So that was Dennis Berry, which we were talking about.
Let's show this. Can you come in on this? Jake, I'm sorry, can you see this?
You open this up right here at this.
Oh, okay.
Right there. You might be better.
Okay, well, let's take a look at the cover first.
This piece traveled around the United States. It traveled to Japan. And in a show... All these different museums, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, Houston.
This one.
And the opening was at ICA in Boston, and they had the Flying Elvises, and the Marilyns jump out of an airplane. And my piece at the show was like 5 feet away from Robert Indiana and Christo. Robert Indiana had one of his Maryland, you know, images in a circle with the Maryland written around it, and Christo had this book with Maryland wrapped up in it, and there's my piece.
Nice.
So then the piece traveled all around and went to Japan, and this is one of the.
That's books. good company.
To I'm telling you.
To be in conjunction
Keith
with.
Keith Haring was in. There's 80 different artists, so it was really exciting.
Yeah. Let's
resume building, big time. Yeah, there it is.
Right here's the This is the one here.
Yeah, that's 13 karat gold on there, and real genuine plastic gems.
I was real genuine plastic.
Real genuine. Plastic.
Yeah, yeah.
That's on canvas.
I like the one on TV. Say these are real people, not actors.
That traveled around for like 8 years. Then it come back in this big crate, so it's like a sarcophagus. And there was another artist, his artwork must have been in there too, an artist named Jim Dine.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah,
his artwork must have been in the same crate at one point. Yeah.
So this one here is a little more expressive.
Yeah, that's called Luna. That's actually with a little more textural. I use a lot of sand with a polymer in it, foils. Okay, this is an awesome piece. This is Man and Woman. Originally, it was called The Watchers. The painting behind it is actually 8 by 8 feet, which is foil. That's at Ursinus College right now in the Performance Center. This is at Villanova.
Mm-hmm.
This wasn't long after 9/11. The two sculptures there are actually about 8 to 9 feet tall, each one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And it represents a man and a woman. You can see it looks like their hands are up to their face. It's sort of traumatized. And you can see, even in those, you see the repeated patterns going all up and down the sides and things.
Oh,
like
yeah, yeah. You see it
it's sort of cubistic.
Over here, the hands are right in here if you're looking.
Right.
So that's...
That was a great show in Villanova.
Mm-hmm.
Villanova is such a long, skinny space. I actually looked at the space and made these pieces
because mm-hmm.
it's so long and narrow, and I thought I need something really eye-catching in the middle or somewhere near the middle.
Mm-hmm.
And
what are these made of?
That's actually wood panel with foil on it.
Mm-hmm. With like aluminum foil?
Yes, I use aluminum foil. So I was buying mm-hmm. industrial aluminum foil from a place in New York State.
Mm-hmm.
It's big rolls. Like it would use them for freezers and freezing.
Oh, very cool.
They're actually in collections, this too.
Mm-hmm.
It's another one of these pieces I had down in Old City.
Yeah, this is the same technique. Same technique with the roller.
Right. Mm-hmm. Oh, this is a good one. This is called Mother and Child. I built a gigantic spin art machine with, it looks like it's probably about 8 by 8 feet by 3 feet high, and it has an electric motor in it.
Yeah.
And I have cables, it's a pulley system, and it had a big handle on it that I could run a belt and then turn a table that would turn these panels.
Mm-hmm. And then you like pour drop paint on it.
Yeah, that's 4 by 4 feet.
Yeah.
So the baby's really spinning.
Yeah.
But I would contain it and then spin it at a very high rate of speed and then pour paint on it, and you get this type of beautiful thing. In the process of doing it, I figured out that, hey, the overspray that was spraying off the horizontal plane, I could probably utilize it inside the ring and spray it onto something else and create another piece of art. So this is titled Mother, and that's Child. The other square piece is actually what flew off the circular pieces it spun, you know, like when you go to a fair or somewhere, it's spinning, and the ink, and the paint, actually it's acrylic, sprayed onto this board, and that's called Child. So it's a product of Mother, and that's Mother.
Very cool.
And that's 4 feet in diameter, and the other is probably 4 feet by another 3 feet.
So all of these are a pretty decent scale.
Well, you've probably seen this piece, Origin. That's also the sand, mm-hmm. the repeated pattern. That was up at Goggle Works at one of the shows.
Mm-hmm.
Has a lot of excitement in that. This is also phase 4. It's very similar to the one that's 8 by 8 feet at Ursinus in the Performance Center. This one is only 20, each panel is 4 panels, 24 inches on each panel.
Mm.
And this is also foil. Now, I have this technique that I scribe into the foil and then put paint, and then I sand it, and I sand different directions to get a moray effect.
Mm-hmm.
So it undulates. As you walk by it,
mm-hmm. Like two screens. Like
exactly.
You have two screens that pass by each other. They tend to create these patterns.
Right. And sometimes when you look at one way, it looks like something else. You look the other way, it looks like something else.
Mm-hmm.
And I just finished a piece this week that's actually an upside down triangle with a split in the middle of it. And it's about 11 feet from corner to corner down to this. And it's like that. It's very, very exciting.
Yeah, and you keep doing things too that are exciting to you,
yeah.
Right? So I mean, so that in doing something that has a somewhat limited or directed process to it, that you can continually find variations within that in order to keep making the work interesting. You know, I remember a statement by Mick Jagger who had said that the reason that he would not have liked the song Angie at all, except for the way that he goes, Angie,
right.
You know. So because of that particular thing, that's what held him to that song. Otherwise, he didn't like it.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
So it's like some things just grab you more than others. But okay. See, I'm trying to go quicker here because we're getting close to time here.
This is called Procession. This is another piece. This is actually on Ampersand. I was buying Ampersand boards. You're familiar mm-hmm. with the Ampersands. They're mm-hmm. archival. They out
Some
of Texas.
Are, yeah, they're made of like a Luan wood that's...
Yeah, yeah. But it's archival, yeah. And I was buying them from the manufacturer in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
This piece was kind of funny because I was making it, and when I ordered the panels from down there, The kid diner says, "Oh, we got some here, but it's got some critters in it." And I go, "What do you mean critters?" He said, "Well, there's critters in it." I go, "What are the critters?" I guess they sprayed it and the critters got in there.
Oh, here bugs
they're,
or something.
They're ladybugs.
Oh.
So I get the panels. Hey, I forgot about it, you know, and I'm sanding away, and all of a sudden, in a couple little spots, I kept seeing these little round circles, so it's actually part of the work, you know. It's the ladybugs, the critters that were in there.
No, how about that?
And another thing with this piece, I had a customer that was interested in it, and, you know, it's a pricey painting. Mm-hmm. And there's little pencil marks. I don't know if you see them, but they're in there. They're like the Mike Hale design elements. And mm-hmm. he mm-hmm. wanted me to remove them. And he said, if I took these out, I might buy the piece. And I'm like, you know, I thought long and hard, and I thought, you know what? I'll keep it. I'm not removing anything.
Mm-hmm.
It really, so... It's, and you can also see the poured paint, the repeated patterns in there,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The different
and how you removed it, or
yep.
It's a process.
When you see it in real life, you can really see the different phases.
That's exactly what it is. That if it, when you see this in, right in front of you,
right, you don't get the texture or the depth of it.
And that has to do with the human touch.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's not like you. It's not like you're painting just designs and patterns and making it all like that green bird flatness that he was so fond of. But you can actually see depth and texture and feeling and the effect of your hand.
Yeah.
Your hands on that.
Yeah. Well, that's a whole other story. You know, it feels good to paint with your hands, you know.
Yeah,
you get
yeah.
that sort of connection that, mm-hmm. I don't know how healthy it is, but, you know, it feels good.
It's what Peter Kinney did that all the time.
Yeah.
He just passed away a little while ago.
Yeah. Every once in a while, I get my fingers in it. After a while, but sometimes you get some pretty, but it's just that connection with it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like playing an instrument like piano, playing in your bare feet, you get that resonating sound that goes through it, and it's like magic, you know, mm-hmm. you feel the whole instrument. It's sort of like that with your art.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's true. It's like an instrument. So this one, I like this one. It's very subtle.
Yeah, it's a property of the Philip and Muriel Berman Museum of Art.
Mm-hmm.
Have that.
It's gorgeous.
That's called. Is that Protector? I think it is Protector.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's Protector. And you see that same shape. It's almost like the other one I showed you, that mm-hmm, wall, that mm-hmm. sort of, that the wall that's, you want to see what's on the other side. Mm-hmm. But yet you get enveloped down inside of it somehow.
Well, it almost feels celestial in a way. Is what I
All my artwork's celestial.
Yeah.
There is sort of a celestial feel to it, and that's how I am. I sort of
mm-hmm.
use my mind and sort of go out there and just, go along, but the shapes are sort of celestial too.
Mm-hmm. Well, it gives me the impression of shapes overlapping, but there's a depth to it.
Yeah.
It's like that curvilinear area up top that's the mostly green there. It looks like that's in the foreground instead mm-hmm. of, you know, instead of just a flat shape. And the what really brings it out is in the center of the painting, that real dark area, and coupled with that. That white, that glow, it seems like a sun right. is behind it, and it's kind of like casting
there's
shadow.
There's this ambient light, and
yeah.
there's these arbitrary things floating around, and it's environmentally sucks you in.
Yeah, yeah. It's a beautiful painting. I love this one.
It's rich, too. Mm-hmm. These colors with the browns and the textures and the worked surface
mm-hmm.
have a leathery, sort of leather-like quality to it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Which you just want to feel it. Now, this is on paper, so it's under glass. You can't really feel it, but yeah, this is a pretty large piece, too. It's also around a 30, 36 inch, 38 or something like that. It's a nice piece.
So you prefer large pieces, then? You prefer painting
larger?
Oh,
I paint paintings are this big. I show anything, but I do like working big.
That's right, because you had some smaller works up at, at Studio
I paint Day. Little paint, big paintings. You know, we hang them in the shows, you know, 15 up, 15 down, 20, you know, that kind of thing. But I also do very large pieces. You know, it's funny, for years, when I lived here, I had a very small car. So I'd take the seats out and put artwork in there because I didn't, you know, and it, then I started renting trucks and that kind of thing. And you know you have made it if the art gets picked up by the gallery in a truck.
In a truck.
That was always nice, but that very rarely happens.
When they do, when that's the best is when the gallery takes care of everything,
I hate driving those U-Haul trucks with stuff in it, but you know, you got to do it. Sometimes I stretch them on site, but you know what? It's usually uncomfortable, and it's just easier just to rent a truck or something. But it all also, you know, it's like a fish in an aquarium. You get bigger, the more, you know, now I can fit more stuff.
Right, so I need a bigger aquarium. We need a bigger boat.
But I encourage, don't be afraid to paint big. It's scary as heck, though, when you got a big white canvas in front of you. It is the scariest thing. I still get scared of it.
It can be terrifying. It really can.
I still get scared, but you got to get something on it. Just get something on it.
Yeah, make a mark. Yeah. Make some kind of mark, and then let it flow. Yeah, that's, here's a spin art.
Yeah, that's a big spin art. That's actually 4 by 4 feet. Now, when in the process of making these things, at one point I was doing something, and the thing flew off and went flying and hit the wall. So then I built like a wall to like put a wall to the whole thing in, so there'd be no way that anything could fly off and do any damage. But that's spinning pretty fast, a lot of RPMs.
Yep. You know, that blue, that central blue, that really rocks. That's really strong.
Those are fun, but you know, I didn't have room for the machine. I eventually tore it apart because I was afraid it, you know, it might rip a limb off or something. So I mean, well. I did it. I had fun, you know. I made some awesome pieces. It was just hogging up too much of my studio, but I still have it. I mean, I invented the whole thing. It was really, really fun to do.
Very nice. Let's move. Keep moving here. We have
That's titled Recoil. That's on paper. That was in a show at the Burnham Museum at one point. That's pretty large. It's about 40 inches by 42 inches. And that's also done with the roller thing.
That's really, it's really interesting because you have like two dimensions.
With the shadowing behind everything, it pushes everything out and gives you this effect of looking through water or you know, three-dimensional feel to it.
Right. It has almost a like a cellular nerve kind of feel to it. Yeah.
That's a work on paper. That's actually down at Lankinol, a doctor's office.
That's really nice.
That's actually a small piece, but you know, less is more. It has a nice sort of feel to it.
I like the intersection there.
Yeah.
The sky and
but
the world.
You can look through the area, so you can actually see there's a lot going on there to the eye that you don't really see.
Well, if you go into that lower that lower area with the browns there, and you take a look into it, it's there is just glaze after glaze on top of that.
Oh, you've seen that. That's nice.
Yeah, I like that.
This is called Rite of Passage. This piece is also, it's probably 5 feet by 4.5 feet. When you look at this thing, it just illuminates, but yet it's so leathery, and the underpainting comes out from the back. You can see the texture of the underpainting. It has these nice line works in it.
Okay, so we have... Oh, and this is a studio shot.
That's how you roll it. You lay it on the floor and roll across it. These are small. Now, that's only 4x4 inch.
Wow, yeah. Well, I'm trying.
That's the spin art machine.
There's the spin art machine. Okay.
That's another 4x4 inch piece.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're
That's another. That's making mother. No, that's actually a spin art machine, but you can see how it's thrown onto the another panel from the other direction, from the horizontal. That's a detail.
Yeah, very cool. Well, we have about 2 minutes left.
That's the piece there that you just saw on the spin art.
So, so let's find out what's next.
If you want to see any of my work, I have some work locally.
Okay.
Your claim to frame in Birdsboro is one spot. And another place is Sweet Mabel in Narberth, Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
There's some work down there.
Okay. And we do have his website and email for anybody that wants to contact him. Can we post that? Just tell us your website for one.
Mike Hale at djazz.com.
Well, that's the email.
That's my email. MikeHaleArtist.com.
Yeah. MikeHaleArtist.com.
Yes.
For the website.
That's the website.
Okay. So if you want to, you can go to either of these sites and take a good look at Mike's work. That's pretty good. Anything else?
No, I'm just excited to be here.
I'm excited to have you here.
How many people do you think you've interviewed? 80 or so?
It's something like that, yeah.
Jeez.
Well, 80 on this show.
Yeah.
You know?
Good for you.
Well, yeah, it's getting close to 1,300 reviews with the newspaper that I've written.
Well, I know you. I know. You're a busy guy.
1996. But, this isn't about me. So anyway, we're just about done. Is there anything that I missed that you would like to say?
Just enjoy art. Just enjoy it. It's just keep plugging along if you're an artist, and be a people person. You know, be courteous and approach people and discuss your art with them, and be open at art shows too. I mean.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of art shows, and I never cease to say, support the arts.
Yes.
Support the arts, even if you don't give any money, it's always a great event to go to one of these openings. And there's a lot of places around here that that have openings on a continual basis, and they do not charge to get in. So, anyhow, we've reached the end of the program.
All right.
Mike Hale, my artist friend, thank you very much.
Thank you.
For joining me tonight.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And I want to thank our viewers for joining us as well. And join us again next time on NAP Connections.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studio in Reading, PA, airing live on the fourth Tuesday of the month at 9 p.m. Check your local listings for repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts Program, call 610-683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5 p.m., Saturday, 10 to 2 p.m., or by appointment.